could be a big night for Sebastian Aho, with a chance to not only set a new NHL record, but to do something not even the great one himself has done, an assist in 13 straight games to start a season. He'll look to do that tonight.
And it'll be a challenge because, of all things, the Arizona Coyotes, they don't give up much. They have been really good, defensively, and so this will be a challenge. But, Billy, Sebastian Aho has really, he's kind of found his way this year, and the addition of Michael Ferland, I think, has been a big plus for him. He gives him a little bit more room, but he's just matured as a player, and he's a terrific talent, and it's coming out in his play now on a night-to-night basis.
Yeah, he's a very cerebral player. This type of player is not that big. He's not 6 foot. He's not 200 pounds. He's below both of those. And he's a heady player. He's the type of player that looks for his teammates first. He's not afraid to play in the middle of the ice, but he looks for his teammates and make the pass first. I watched him the other night doing the Boston Bruins against Carolina. And, the Bruins did a decent job against him. But, still, along with Ferland, along with Tara Vinen, early on in the season, they've done a very nice job. We touched on it yesterday, but speaking of taking a transition from Yanni Gourde signing his contract. So now, Aho wants at least $6.5 or probably $7 million a year. And, if he keeps producing, if he gets the record tonight, it might add a few shekels to that as well.
For more on Hockey Fights Cancer, we bring in NHL.com's Emily Benjamin, who wrote about Lauren's new role. I want to start with Nicole, who did this last year, the wife of Craig Anderson. Did she have any sort of part in helping pick who the face of this campaign was going to be this year?
I think it was more about sort of finding a way to pass the torch from her to someone who's also been touched by cancer. And Lauren Boyle certainly has that, unfortunately. So I got to go a couple of weeks ago to the Prudential Center in New Jersey and sort of watch the torch pass from Nicole to Lauren Boyle and watch them get to have a conversation about what being this ambassador means and the ways that they can help and spread the word and do everything they can to both promote Hockey Fights Cancer and just to fight cancer.
What are some of the ways, Emily, that they've told you that they can get out there and do those kind of things in the community?
Yeah, Nicole Anderson last year was very involved. She clearly was very touched by being part of this community, by talking to people. It's amazing how educated she unfortunately is now on this topic. She is working to get purple lipsticks, at least right now, to the Ottawa Senators. They're going to sell those on their Hockey Fights Cancer night. And potentially those could be available in other rinks around the NHL. They're still working on that. Lauren Boyle, meanwhile, is working on, she's going to have a jewelry sale with a bunch of the NHL wives, especially those in the tri-state area, to raise hopefully a ton of money to fight cancer. And they both have, Nicole from last year and continuing, and Lauren both have really big plans as to what they are and are going to be doing.
And Emily, you recently wrote an article on NHL.com about the relationship between these two women who unfortunately have a shared or common experience that they've dealt with over the last couple of years. What can you tell us about their relationship and how they have sort of helped each other through the last couple of years?
Yeah, it was great. I got to watch them have this conversation, and it was just amazing, the understanding between the two of them. You could hear each one say things about treatments or about dealing with side effects, and they really understood each other, and they really understood what the other person went through, is going through. It was great to see Lauren Boyle tell Nicole Anderson that Brian had gone through his testing and his levels had come out in all zeros, and Nicole was so excited. It was just a great moment to see how excited she was about hearing this great news about Brian Boyle and just the understanding and that feeling, that unfortunate cancer family that they're both a part of. I think they really get each other, and I think they're hoping to pass that feeling along to those who also have been suffering through cancer you know, around the NHL, people that they'll deal with as being the ambassador.
And one thing that really stood out to me in your article on NHL.com as well was that Nicole, oh, she might not be the ambassador this year for the National Hockey League. You mentioned the purple lipstick. She has no plans of stopping in terms of being involved in the community and helping families that are dealing with this very same thing. So she's still very much a part of the initiative and a part of raising awareness around cancer. So very happy for her. And I can only imagine Lauren's going to do a fantastic job. You can read Amelie's article on NHL.com. Thank you for this.
Thanks, Jackie.
Take us through the second. I love when you break stuff down.
Yeah, well,
so take
Billy and I were going
goals.
Through some of these, a couple of the second and the third goal, and they're both really interesting goals. And we'll start with the Josi goal late in the period. And I think this is really part and parcel of what the Preds like to do with their defensemen, Billy. They like to activate their guys, and this is what happens.
Well, Josi comes up, makes a nice play after he falls down, makes a great play down to Johansson, but then he leaves his area. He keeps going forward. He's not thinking backwards. Here's your box and one defense, basically, four guys around the guy in the middle. The guy in the middle, though, is Strawman. He's focusing on the puck, which is Johansson, and Josi says, I'll see you later. Backhand swivel pass.
Oh.
Perfectly right there. But I want you to keep an eye on something in front, too. Forsberg and McDonough have been battling the whole time. Earlier, Forsberg went down. Right when that pass went through, McDonough went down. That left the lane open.
Yeah, and this is now in the third period. Now, 3:27 left, one goal game. Your Stamkos with the puck, high slot on your forehand. Get the puck to the net because Nashville has got this played really good. You can see Ryan Johansson just waiting for that pass across to Kucherov, who wants to one-time it. I'd rather see the shot there. Nice play by Johansson. Down the ice he comes, Billy, then really nicely executed on the two-on-one.
Beautiful execution there. Just waits for the D-man to go down. Watch right here. Kucherov's like, wait, you did what? Now I got to get back? So now it's a two-on-one. Strowman's going to go down. And right when he goes down, that's just a read by Johansson. His hands are in the right spot. He has the puck to the middle. The defenseman sliding across there, Strawman.
A little
thinks,
early,
maybe,
right?
Yeah, literally that millisecond early. Thinks, if I can go down, I can block that pass. He's saying, nope, I'll see it. He drags it in, quick to the backhand and over. Johansson is fully engaged this year. He's fully healthy. He's fully engaged. This is going to be a major reason. If they can go on to the Stanley Cup, Ryan Johansson is going to have to play exactly how he is right now. He's been that good, that impactful for this team. But getting back to your comment, dead on, about Stamkos and Kucherov right there. I saw that in the playoffs last year, too. Yeah. They start looking for each other too much, and that becomes a negative. It's always nice to be unselfish. Get the puck through. Yeah. Don't make a turnover in that area. Yeah. Otherwise, those two guys, they're not doing their job then.
Yeah, the Nashville Predators come out on top, and they are certainly looking like a team that might just win another President's Trophy this year. They've looked spectacular. You saying Duke is on fire. Anthony Duclair.
Yeah. He could wear an ascot right now. The Duke is so hot. He could. It's suave.
It'd be funny to see on the ice.
Yes, it would. But off the ice, I'm talking about. He's got style on the ice. How about some style off the ice, too? Anthony Duclair has worked really hard this year. We talked to people in Columbus. They love what he's doing. I love what Murray does here. This is a half slapper, a little punch. He's already looking for Duclair. So he knows that he has to get it away from the front of the net where there's a bunch of sharks, right? They're swimming. They're circling. Go wide. Duclair gives him a target, doesn't get it, though, off the end wall, and then utilizes it. Watch his, see his curve right here? That's the toe curve I was talking about. This will come into play. Right coming up as he sees the whole net is wide open. Dell is way out of his net. And now, because of the quick reaction and the edge work with the inside edge, he's able to go and watch him a little tuck move right here. That nice big curve lets him corral the puck and a little slide into the empty net.
That's nice.
Anthony Duclair, and I talked to Kenny McCutton, who's their skills coach here.
Yeah.
He gets Kenny. He'll call him every day at the end of practice or ask him at the end of practice every day, can we work on something? Great work ethic, great determination. And let's face it, not so great for the last couple of years.
Yeah.
He's kind of floundering in the NHL. The Duke is going right now.
Good.
Can he keep it up? We'll have to wait and see. But his skill set and his speed, Jackie, are outstanding. Yeah.
Speaking of records, the Montreal Canadiens set one last night in Montreal, scoring the fastest two goals by one team in NHL history. Armia scoring just 2 seconds after Max Domi.
Yeah, off the empty net, you see bang. I mean, that's, think about it. Fastest two goals in NHL history. Not like this season. So there it is. There's the old mark, the old St. Louis Eagles. I remember covering them back in the day. Minnesota Wild, New York Isles, also tied
You're
it
gradually
up.
Becoming Stan Fischler.
Yes, well, I might be older than Stan, you never know. But, you know, I'll tell you what, I see Braden Holtby give up that goal to Max Domi. Oh, good for Max Domi. Yeah. And the Montreal Canadiens have had that kind of...
He's been a great fit for them.
They've had that kind of success this year. Remember Brendan Gallagher scoring that late goal against the Blues a couple weeks ago? But I know the Vegas Golden Knights are watching that and going, where was that Braden Holtby? Like, where was that guy last year when we needed him? You know, because that was one that he wants back. But congratulations to the Canadiens.
That was a fun game last night.
Yeah, it was back and forth, and both teams having leads, and got to give the Montreal.
I was just going to say, I mean, we haven't talked about them too much on this show, but what they've been able to do the first month of the season, I don't think anybody expected this from the Habs.
No, they did not. And anybody that did is a liar.
you know, they knew. Jaffe's calling you out.
Yeah. Don't tell me you said you're going to thought they're going to be after a month at the top of the division or right up there. Claude Julien and his staff have done a beautiful job getting Carey Price back to the regular Carey Price status.
It helps
an awful lot. Yep. But the way that Claude Julien and his staff have promoted the fast game, the quick game, the less, he didn't slow it down, but it was a more methodical type of play. Now it's get it up the ice. They're using the smaller forwards. The
guys are jumping in.
The guys that are darting around, even their D, even guys like Jordy Benn getting involved.
In.
We're seeing the D get involved. And that change has made a significant difference in Montreal. And they're getting at, they're like a pack of, you know, dogs after you when they get on the forecheck. They're nipping at your heels. Because they can skate well. So far, so good in Montreal. The big question, can they keep it up? You know what? They don't have to worry about that right now. They got to worry about the game that's the next one or last night, that Washington game.
And it's a big game for them.
They took it to a pretty darn good team.
And you know what? I'm going to say one thing. And I know Capitals fans are going to be irritated with this because it is only a month into the season.
Warning, EJ.
And they just won the Stanley Cup. But I've been watching the Washington Capitals now at the start of the season, and there has been a lot of slippage in their play, their attention to detail. Now, we're way early, but if teams like Montreal continue to play well, if Florida now with Luongo gets going, if some of these teams, the Islanders are off to a pretty good start, Carolina, like, it's not going to be as easy to nail down one of those eight spots in the East as we thought it might be. They're loaded in Washington. They should certainly be a playoff team, and they have a chance to repeat. But it's a long season, and a lot of things can happen, and they're squandering some opportunities here early in the year, and I'd be a little concerned about what I've seen so far.
Joined now by director Gabe Pulsey. Gabe, we heard one word Wayne Gretzky say a couple of times in that quick clip, creativity. And that's really the essence of what this film's about.
It is. It's, you know, basically it's about the nature of greatness and what that is creativity. You know, when we go to the stadium, we're looking for, you know, something we've never seen before. We want to see that magical moment that where you turn to the guy next to you and say, how did he do that, you know? And really the greatest athletes of all time that populate my film, you know, Muhammad Ali, Michael Jordan, Wayne Gretzky, Jerry Rice, these are guys that look at themselves as, you know, artists and creative people, and that's how they became the greatest of all time.
You mentioned you interviewed so many different people here, and obviously Gretz and Jerry Rice and Pele are the feature, but what was the most interesting guy or moment in those interviews?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of interesting moments, and, you know, I wouldn't, I think everything's interesting because I don't like, you know, anything boring in a film, but I think, you know, one of the things that really interested me about Wayne Gretzky, we're talking hockey here, is that, you know, he talked about basically remembering every single play of every game he's ever played in, and I couldn't, you know, that basically, when he said that to me, I almost fell off my chair because I just can't even comprehend how someone could do that, but it's anecdotes like that that populate the entire film. You know, like Jerry Rice, for instance, talking about how he was never late for a single practice, and he usually shows up 20 minutes early. You know, things like that. And Pelé talking about how basically he would get benched a lot when he was a kid because he was too kind of experimental. Mm-hmm. And so things like that you know, I think are going to really surprise people when they see this film. It's not what you expect. You know, greatness, we look at a lot of physical things, size, speed, and strength. It has nothing to do with that. It's all about artistry and about experimentation and play.
But a lot of these guys, too, Gabe, you know, we talked yesterday, in fact, on the show about how some of the best players don't end up making great coaches because they can't explain how they did what they did.
Yeah.
So these guys might not, I mean, I guess, weren't maybe comfortable talking about what they did. Was it more about how they did it and what led them to their greatness? Because it comes in all different forms,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing you pointed out, because I did ask Wayne about his coaching career. And he said, whether you like it or not, he said, listen, if I had the Edmonton Oilers in the 1980s, I'd be considered a great coach. You know,
true.
So that's one thing. I think, you know, in terms of explaining it, it is... artistry and creativity is kind of hard to explain, but one thing that these guys did harp on was the fact that they, you know, when they were younger, they played a lot in the backyard. That's where they developed their skills, their creativity, and sort of understood their weaknesses, who they are as people, and were able to develop, basically use their imagination to develop their particular skill set.
And I think, too, as you're talking about, you know, guys never being late to a single practice, and Gretzky, remember, every single play in every single game that he played, and he played in a lot of games.
Yes, he did.
It's that attention to detail that really comes from passion, genuine passion for their craft. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, greatness cannot be manufactured. You cannot push a kid to become great. I mean, it has to come from within. It has to be tremendous love, bordering on almost OCD.
Obsessive.
We could call it OCD, whatever you name it. It's that love where they can't stop doing what they're doing. They'd rather play hockey all day long versus go to the movies or do anything with their friends because they just love it. That's what they love doing. And that's something that comes from within. It can't be created in a sports academy or somewhere else. That's what it is.
And that's kind of, too, sorry to jump in, EJ, but we talk about hockey sense a lot. When you guys are talking about the game, he has great hockey sense, great hockey smarts, and that's kind of a part of the game. You could be the fastest, the strongest, have the hardest shot, but if you don't understand the game or you don't have the hockey sense, then you are not going to be, you know, Wayne Gretzky.
Yeah, but the hockey sense, you know, a lot of people, I think, are misinformed about hockey sense because I do believe that it can be developed. It's not something you're necessarily born with. You study the game, you really understand it, you internalize it. It's not an intellectual thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it becomes an intuitive thing. And,
yes.
And that can be developed. It can be easily developed. But kids think, oh, I either have it or I don't have it. That's not true.
Let me ask you brought up the fact that a lot of these guys, you talked about playing as young children, playing outdoors, and the world is changing dramatically now. When I was growing up, on different streets, there'd be kids playing touch football or street hockey or different things. Now I drive through neighborhoods, there's never any kids playing on the street. Yeah. What they do now is you're playing when the games are set up for you. It's more formal now.
Yeah.
Is there a concern when you talk to some of these different guys about the future for developing great players and great athletes?
Big concern. I mean, like I said before, listen, you could go to sports academy, you could do these structured drills over and over, but then what happens is you become a robot, okay?
Yeah.
You have great technical ability, you've got great physical skills, but you don't have a poetry or an artistry to the game, and that's why we spend money. You know what I'm saying? We're not going there to see technical robots.
Yeah.
We want to see something beautiful.
Flair.
So yeah, and a voice.
Yeah.
With all that said, you also did the film on the Red Army. All right. So they were you want to talk about a rigid, controlled environment. How then, in your opinion and for your work, do you think they were able to be such a dynamic, dominant team, despite the fact that they were literally, in some ways, forced to do that?
Yeah, so the irony with that is that the coach, Viktor Tikhonov, of this in the 80s of this Russian dynasty, it was so rigid off the ice, but once they got on the ice, they actually had a lot of freedom to do what they did best and be creative. I know Igor Larionov and Fetisov would always say that basically the only time they ever felt free was on the ice together. So when they're on the ice, they were free, but off the ice, it was rigid and a terrible life, basically, yeah.
And that, when that started, though, in watching your film, when it first started, there was a different coach there, and it was a different way of thinking, wasn't it?
Yeah, with Anatoly Tarasov, who was sort of this, you know,
such a guy who was ahead of his time when it came to hockey.
Yeah, I mean, he was a philosopher more than a coach, and really kind of studied dance and poetry. Basically, you know, created the beautiful hockey that we saw. But then once he was removed, because he basically made the president angry, and they fired him. And
they couldn't do that in the
finer details, right?
But after that, it became kind of just very rigid and painfully kind of isolating for the players.
Mm. Now, before we let you go, my understanding, you and Jaffe actually know each other from way back. We need to explain this to the viewers very quickly.
It was 1997, the first ever World Maccabi Games that included ice hockey.
Okay.
In the northernmost, pretty much the northernmost town of Israel, on the border of Israel and Lebanon. Metula is the name. There's a hockey rink up there, a full-sized, it's called the Canada Center, full-fledged hockey rink that they brought in hockey players from, well, around the world, a few countries. That was it. It was U.S., Canada, Israel had a team, and the Ukraine had a team there as well. We had a great time. What a learning experience.
He was like the elder statesman and like...
I was the old man.
Was the veteran. And the guy was like, you know, I would just sort of... I hadn't even gone to college yet, so I was scared of Billy.
I still am. I really am.
We had a great time.
I'm scared of him.
We lost to Canada in the gold medal game.
We had a good time.
And then you're talking about remembering details, 5-3 in the gold medal game. To Team Canada. David Nemirovsky led the way for Team Canada.
Yeah. There's a memory right there.
We had him. We had Justin Dubrin, Dave Heimovich. I can remember the whole team.
I love it. I love seeing you smile as you talk about this. It was obviously a very good time. But at the core of this conversation, we were talking about what makes the greatest athletes in the world great. If that is a subject that interests you, you can see In Search of Greatness. It is in theaters today. I mentioned power rankings. You guys are, you know, getting into it a little early there. But the time is now. The stage is
playing
yours.
The role of Dan Rosen will be me.
You're way smarter than Rosen. All right,
this is mine.
What
do you got? Stop talking, EJ.
What do you got, Jeff?
Number one, Preds. All right, pretty obvious. Number two, Lightning. I thought they played a good game against the Preds, but Pecorino being a big difference. Even though the Jets lost today, I'm still sticking with them as the number three team, although I am questioning every once in a while some sanity about this team. I think they might be 4 or 5, but I kept them at 3. Canadians ahead of the Bruins. I can't believe that Montreal Canadiens are this high in my power rankings, but I'm basing it on what they've done the last couple of games. And since they did beat the Bruins a week ago, I'm putting them ahead of the Boston Bruins that are still banged up tremendously, getting amazing goaltending, though, from Jaroslav Halak. That's my top five. EJ,
You're close, Billy. What's yours? Oh, I got to agree with you, the first two, Predators and Lightning. The Jets were in mine originally, but losing today,
I quickly
flipped them out of there. You know, they've taken the eighth most penalties in the league. They can't take penalties.
Shocker. They take the number.
But last year they were down.
Yeah.
That's a problem for me.
Islanders,
Canadians for me. This is NHL Now, as we like to say. We could sit here like, you know, we always have these arguments about the philosophical looking at it of like, I could always say, well, Penguins, Caps, the teams that we think are going to be there. But right now, the Islanders are playing well.
They won four in a row.
Four in a row, and they beat the Penguins back-to-back. And the Penguins had been playing really well up to that point, so give the Islanders credit. And the Canadians just had the nice win over the Boston Bruins in Boston, so I have to give them the edge.
Well, Boston and Washington.
That's right.
Two in a row for them right there, and they're picking it up. Here we see the Islanders.
But you basically agree with me that mine are accurate. Thank you, Billy.
No, I don't really. I agree that you're first two are very accurate.
Thank you, Billy.
And I agree with you having Montreal in there, too. The Calgary and the Islanders, I mean, look, I'm just trying to support this, all right? I'm just trying to support you to make you feel good. After you went 2-10.
Yeah.
2-10, you should have seen the text that I was getting from EJ, the emojis.
I was by 11 o'clock, I was done. I was just watching the scores at that point because I knew anything that was going to go wrong last night was just going to continue to go wrong, and it did. But, I got to give – there's yours again. The Jets to me, like, we know they're really good. They have a lot of talent.
Right.
But right now, I just...
I know. I actually, I did think about taking them out after the loss today. Yeah. But I just didn't have enough time to really go ahead and do it. They were pushing me for it, and I didn't know the order. So I'm going to keep them in. I thought they played a nice game yesterday. Today, not so much. But, otherwise, there's a few other teams on the precipice. I know the Penguins got beat.
You don't have the Flames. Why not the Flames? They've been playing better.
They have been playing better. They were right at my night six. I had between the Bruins, the Flames, the Penguins, 5, 6, 7, 8. Isles right up there. Absolutely.
Rolling. Yep. Rolling those Islanders right now.
Barry Trotz.
We bring in our good friend Tyson Nash. Tyson, this team is looking to win its fifth straight game. They have been on fire. What's the difference been over the last five games versus the team's first six?
Oh man, there's been so much good stuff going on here in Arizona. You want to talk about entertainment, Jackie? Watch this team here tonight. They are a tough out, no question. Nobody wants to play these guys right now. But really, for me, it was the start of the year. They weren't getting outplayed. They were outplaying the opposition. They were outchancing the opposition, but they weren't finding the back of the net. They scored just 3 goals in their first 5 games. So it was a real struggle. But really, their last 5 games, they are finding the back of the net. 23 goals in their last 5 games, and they've only allowed 4 goals in their last 4 games. So they're doing it at both ends of the ice. Defense has been solid, and they're getting the goals.
And they're also getting contributions from some new faces in Arizona as well. How have some of these players been able to mesh together so well so quickly?
Well, you got to give John Chyka a ton of credit here. This is a guy that went out and he filled all the holes that this team really had going into the season. And you look at starting with Darcy Kemper. He came in. He's done a remarkable job. The second best tandem in the league. Then you got Galchenyuk. So important. Probably one of the biggest trades in the offseason for Max Domi. It's really worked out well for both clubs. Grabner, this is a guy that scored 54 goals in his last 2 seasons. Not a single goal on the power play. He's done an unreal job this year on the penalty kill. Both his goals have come shorthanded. And Hinostroza and Osterley, what a trade this was. This was a trade basically for that Hossa contract from Chicago. And really kind of that Vegas effect John Chyka was hoping for, that given more ice time, given a bigger role on the hockey club, they would put up big numbers, and that's been the case.
Yeah, it seems to be working lately. Goaltending has also been pretty solid, and that's impressive considering that the two goaltenders are actually splitting time. Because they're splitting time, how have they been able to stay sharp?
Well, for Darcy Kemper, that's the big question. I mean, it's tough to be a backup goaltender, be ready when you're behind a guy like Antti Raanta. But Antti Raanta happened to get sick, and in went Darcy Kemper, and he played 3 solid games for the Coyotes. I think he had 2 30-plus save performances, and that's really kind of where this role kind of started, that 4-game tear that they're on right now. You need goaltending. Goaltending is the backbone. As I mentioned, the second-best tandem with Raanta and Kemper in the entire NHL. So they're getting goaltending, they're getting defense, and they're getting that offense. And they're scoring goals shorthanded, which is absolutely remarkable. 6 goals shorthanded, if you can believe it.
So essentially, you could say they are rolling on all cylinders, the Arizona Coyotes. They will look to make it 5 straight Ws tonight. They're taking on the Carolina Hurricanes. Tyson, always a pleasure.
Thanks, Jack.
We go to Tampa, where Yanni Gourde has signed a 6-year, $5.166 million extension with the Lightning. That is the annual salary, $31 million over 6 years.
Woo! That's all I could say. And yes. Great for Yanni Gourde, because here's a guy that was not drafted. He wasn't even drafted in the Q. He ended up not getting to play in the QHL until he was 18 as a junior player. ECHL, AHL, finally gets a chance in the National Hockey League, and now he's become a really important part of the Tampa Bay Lightning. Certainly they feel that way. They signed him to that 6-year contract, $5.16 annual average salary. That's a pretty big number there.
Oh.
Looking forward with the Tampa Bay Lightning, this is the team that has to worry about every single contract because they've got so many really high-end players there, so they have to worry about the cap implications. But the one thing I take out of this, Billy, is if for some reason, when they have to look at signing Point in the future, and he's an RFA at the end of the year, mm-hmm. or Vasilevskiy, and depending on where the cap is, that is a contract, if he continues to play well, that they'll be able to trade. So for me, I think it's a good deal for the Tampa Bay Lightning.
Great deal for the player. Very solid deal for the Tampa Bay Lightning, too. The guy, he's coming off a two-year deal that he made about $1 million a year, was where he was at in his contract. He's the type of player that you rooted for because of what EJ just referenced about not being drafted, but also just because of the way that he went about his game. Very humble, very grateful for the opportunity. I remember talking to him an awful lot last year during the Eastern final between Tampa and Washington. He was very gracious with his time, and he was, I don't want to say refreshing, but the reality, watching him, of saying, just loving every minute of it, just where he is at. It was
in the moment.
In the moment, totally with it. And again, very gracious with his time, too, so from a broadcaster's perspective. You always appreciate that. He's also putting up numbers that in this day and age, as the salary cap goes up, players that are up each year are going to get a little bit more, And he's reaping the rewards for that. But your point about being a tradable asset eventually could be. And there's a few others.
As long as he produces, and it looks like he will.
There's a few others on that team, too, that I think that they wouldn't hesitate to. And there's going to be one or two guys at the end of this year that they're not going to bring back. They're either not going to re-sign or, they're not going to bring
back. It's all part of the managing the cap. And that's something they'll have to look forward to down there. But good
signing by Breezeball.
Yeah, that's right. His first kind of major signing so for Julian Breezeball. But congratulations to Yanni Gourde. His wife and he just had a baby a couple months back. So congratulations. Awesome news. And he's earned it.
Yeah, and he, part of that deal, too, three-year no trade the first three. Nice. Full no trade the first 3 years of that deal. So a little bit of security there for him as well in terms of where he will be for the next 3 years.